Let's talk about Indoor Garden Party. I think you have known Alan Doyle a long time. Does your songwriting partnership go all the way back to, I think, The Ordinary Fear of God, the band you formed after 30-odd foot of grunt?
I was in Canada making Cinderella Man.
Right.
And they asked me to present at the NHL Awards.
Yes. Right.
And we'd sort of always introduce it as a great big sea song. And so he was also on the bill as a guest at that NHL being the National Hockey, was the only hockey league in Canada, right? And they were the musical guest, his band, Great Big Sea. So he sort of manufactured to bump into me backstage.
Right.
And we just started having a chat, you know, and he just said, man, if you ever want to, you know, I know you sing the song, blah, blah, if you ever want to get together and write a song, great. So we ended up setting a studio up in the hotel that I was staying at while I was shooting in Canada, and we wrote, the first song we wrote together is a song called Raven.
Right.
I think that's on the Ordinary Fear of God song, My Hand, My Heart.
Yeah.
The album, My Hand, My Heart. And that song is the absolute reason why we kept writing together, you know. And as it's turned out, you know, that was 2004, it's 2017 now.
Yeah.
I'm the person that Alan's written the most songs with in his musical career, and he's the person I've written the most songs with.
Right.
So Indoor Garden Party, just it starts with that songwriting partnership, and then sort of reaching out to friends and saying, you know, why don't you sing this one, you know?
Yes.
And that's sort of how the shows are, you know. It's, you know, they have an informal air, there's a lot of storytelling going on, but, you know, that's sort of interspersed with some really passionate and beautiful singing voices, you know.
Mm. I'm guessing you came across Samantha Barks when you were working on the film version of Les Miserables. She's had a...
Well, Samantha sang the role of Eponine, so, you know, I mean, she's just got an amazing voice.
Mm.
She's brilliant.
Did she
and,
feel like...
We were doing some concerts in New York in... it was the end of 2012, which I think is the same year that we shot Les Mis.
Yeah.
And we just asked Samantha if she'd like to sit in. She was, you know, fabulous. And that was mainly doing the songs from an album called The Crow Doyle Songbook, Volume 3.
Yeah.
Go looking for Volumes 1, 2,
right.
I mean, it's only the one. It was a perverse title, but that's, you know, it's the way it is. She just became part of what we do now, you know, and so she's one of the principal voices, you know. It's a funny old band, this, mate. There's five people in it. I live in Sydney, Australia.
Yeah.
Scott lives in Los Angeles. Alan lives in Newfoundland. Samantha lives in London. And Carl Falk lives in Stockholm in Sweden. So getting together for rehearsals is a bitch, you know, but that's actually, funnily enough, adds to the energy that we create when we're on stage together, because it is special for all of us, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And everybody's got such big lives and big schedules that, you know, the last concerts we did were in Australia in 2014. And here it is, like 3 years later, and we only get three nights together, you know.
Yeah.
Immediately after the show, everybody's like, straight on, I'm off to Atlanta, Scott's back to a TV show, Carl's in will be doing somebody's album at that time, Alan's in the middle of a North American tour, and Samantha will most likely be performing in New York at that time. So we just got to grab the time we have.
Yeah. Scott, I'm guessing, was another film connection. I think Carl's got a background very much in sort of modern pop music with the likes of One Direction and Ariana Grande. Did you want some of that to bring some of that him to bring some of that sort of sensibility to this project?
Well, Scott, my relationship with him goes back to a movie called Mystery Alaska in 1998.
Yeah.
And we sort of started singing together back then, just, you know, as friends. With Carl, I actually had no idea of Carl's history or background or anything. I was at a party in Los Angeles, and for an Australian singer called Delta Goodrum's house.
Yeah.
And I was working on some songs at the time, and there were these guys there. There were some sort of hot producing directions, you go to where the best stereo is, which happens to be in the Cadillac outside, you know, in the Esplanade, rather than play it inside. So, you know, seven or eight people crammed into this SUV. I put on the CD of the stuff that I was working on, played like three or four songs, and, you know, they're all very complimentary or whatever, and then they left the vehicle, and there was just one bloke sitting in the back seat.
Yeah.
So I said, by what percentage? Being a smartass, you know. And I'm thinking he's going to come back and say 1,000%, you know, 10,000%, you know.
Yeah.
And he really put some thought in it, and he said, maybe 30%. We bonded purely over the fact that he connected to a couple of songs of him.
Yeah.
You know, and he's amazing, man. You know, he plays 23 instruments, and, you know, he's just incredible. But, you know, at one point in time, I just turned to him and I said, you know, do you want to be in the band? And he was like, man, nobody's asked me to be in a band in a long time. I'd love to, you know. So, you know, instead of just working on the songs, it became an integral part of how we create the songs, you know.
What do you feel binds you all together as a band? You're playing in Leeds on the UK tour in September. Was that choice in any way influenced by your well-documented affection for Leeds United?
You can't fool you, can you? Well, you know, I've got, you know, quite other associations to Yorkshire in general, and a great love for Yorkshire, really, you know. Actually, Michael Parkinson saw one of the first indoor garden parties ever in 2009. We put it on at his pub.
Right.
And he said after that show that he thought it was one of the best shows he'd ever been to.
Right.
Because of how we interact, how we bring other people from a stage, how, you know, we sort of set people up in the audience to enjoy in what we're doing. And, you know, actually that was what he said afterwards, one of the best things he'd ever seen. It was probably one of the things that that encouraged us to keep going with the idea, you know.
Right.
But yeah, so I've got, you know, a longer family history that goes back. I married a girl whose mum comes from Yorkshire, you know. Obviously, I stole some of the greatest football players recently, some of the greatest rugby league players that Yorkshire's ever produced, and the Burgess brothers. And, you know, they won a championship for South Sydney. And, you know, so there's many connections. But, of course, you know, Leeds United is one of them as well.
Are you hoping to catch a Leeds game whilst you're over here?
I made an agreement with myself. I'm not going to go and see Leeds play again until they're at the top of their game.
Right.
Until they're in the Premiership.
Right.
You know, and you know, people might think that's this or that, but you know, I keep up to date with the results and follow their form and stuff. But yeah, they're not where they should be. They're not where they deserve to be, and they will be soon. You know.
Yeah.